Hey guys! So, in honor of Inktober, we're going to do an inking project today. And the materials you're going to need to follow along with this project are some Strathmore Toned Tan Paper, a Sailor Mitsuo Aida double-sided brush pen slash fude pen, WInsor and Newton Gold ink or the gold ink of your choice, Inktober opaque white or the white gouache of your choice. And you're also going to want to have an illustration that you've completed. And I'll go ahead and zoom in so you guys can see what I've got here. It's a little drawing of my character, Kara. And this illustration is going to use black, white, tone tan, and gold as the main colors. We're going to begin by just doing a general outline. So, you know, simple inking. We're going to take our time because we're in no big hurry. Inktober is, after all, 31 days, so you got plenty of time. And sure, you could make 31 different pieces, or you could make 15 pieces that take 2 days each, or three pieces that you spent 10 days on and an extra day to scan everything. Really, these sort of challenges are not about stressing out. They aren't about competition by any means. They're just about finding stuff that works for you and doing it and participating in the whole community. And if something about it stresses you out, feel free to change it. You should feel a little bit of pressure, but you certainly should not feel sick over it. It shouldn't intimidate you to the point where you can't do anything at all. If you find that happening, feel free to go ahead and modify how you're approaching it. I know people who use Inktober as a way to push themselves to get that chapter inked in 31 days. I know people who use Inktober to put together a little mini, something that they wouldn't normally have time to do. They make time. That's what I like to do. I know people who use Inktober to break out the traditional inks when normally they do all digital. And vice versa, people who do digital practicing their, people who do traditional practicing their digital inks. You know, that's what's so great about these challenges is it gives us a chance to sort of stretch our wings and find out new things if we want to. Inktober could be a good time for you to collaborate with a friend. And each of you prepare a bunch of drawings that the other person inks. That's really great if you have a friend whose style is completely different from yours. I learned so much inking other people's art when I was taking advanced inking techniques at SCAD. In fact, some of my favorite pieces were on other people's line art just because it was so different from what people expected from me, and it sort of earned me new respect. Because people had kind of pigeonholed me into this very sweet sort of shoujo wannabe anime kid box. But that isn't all that I was. That was just kind of my default. So having the opportunity to ink other people's stuff, allowed me to show them that I was interested in other things and that I had other abilities. In fact, I would really love to be able to do that again, ink other people's stuff. And I'm always trying to arrange collaborations and then, you know, something always falls through. Usually it's on the other party's part. They just get really busy and they don't have enough time to put something together in the time frame we agreed upon. Which is a shame. I do enjoy working on other people's stuff. And of course, since we're basically doing it as an exchange, it means we both have to, both parties have to find a time that works for them, because it's not like you're getting paid. It's not like you can afford to make the time. So, you know, the older you get, the harder that can be. So if you're in an, if you are in a situation where you have the opportunity to collaborate with someone, please take it. You'll end up learning all sorts of things. And you'll end up with new stuff in your portfolio. And you'll get to practice working in a team. That's always an important skill. Something I definitely miss about Savannah is I had a group of friends and we would do three-way trades where we'd each make a line art. And then, you know, we'd rotate it, basically pass it to the person to our left. They'd ink it, pass it on again, the next person would color it. Just a really good way to get a variety of styles in your portfolio. Sort of also a good way to simulate the art school experience at home. Give me a second, my cat wants out the room. Oh, well, I'll tell you guys something that's a little bit of a secret. I'm preparing for a conference this weekend, and my anxiety has been pretty high. I do have troubles with anxiety. I have my entire life. I've seen doctors for it too. I also have problems with depression. Many artists do. There's no shame in that, you know. You can be a wonderful, functional person and still deal with these things. It doesn't make you any less. But I was feeling pretty stressed out today for a variety of reasons. And I thought, you know, maybe it would be nice to record a calm video with you guys in case you're feeling kind of anxious too, for whatever reason. You know, we could just have like a nice chat, work on something together. That noise you hear in the background is my printer. You know, just sort of like hang out. Maybe I could give you guys some encouragement, help you prep for Inktober, or, you know, anytime you want to do a neat little project. Toned tan paper is a lot of fun to work with. The white really pops off. Looks really nice. And, you know, you could draw whatever you want to draw. Believe it or not, for me, a lot of the anxiety comes from not the actual act of drawing, but it's a fear of the unknown, and there's a bit of imposter. There's a lot of imposter syndrome in there, where even though I have these credentials and I've done all this work, I always feel like somebody's gonna call me out, and I've had some pretty negative experiences, so my brain can definitely rationalize why that would happen. And it's pretty scary for me, and it makes it hard for me to pursue new activities. I'm telling you guys this because if you're dealing with this, I don't want you to feel alone. I want you to know that there's somebody else who struggles with it and is doing their best, and maybe that will inspire you to do your best, and maybe it'll help you out and give you courage. I hope that's the goal. But, you know, chatting with you guys a little bit, working on a tutorial, doing some inking. Inking can be very calming, very relaxing, because it allows you to sort of hyper-focus on one thing. And if you're starting to like disassociate, that can be a very helpful thing to do, is to focus on one thing. Helps you pace your breathing, because you do your best inking with controlled breathing. You know, it can be very grounding. Anyway, the reason I'm anxious is it's a children's book conference, and I'm a comic artist, and I do comics for kids, but my background is in comics. I went to school for comics. I don't have a background in illustration. A lot of what I know about illustration has been stuff I've learned from reading or from talking to people, but it's not like a formal education, and there's just so much for me still to learn, and I'm just always afraid of making a huge faux pas. I'm always afraid that I will do something unwittingly and just wreck my chances. And in comics that can happen, you know, if somebody catches you at the wrong time, you've had a bad con, you might be feeling a little snippy and you may be a little bit, just a little sassy to the wrong person without ever knowing it. And it can just kind of halt your career and you won't know why. So, you know, that is something I do think about. I do worry about it. It has kept me up many, 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 many nights. And I'm telling you guys this because, you know, we don't actually talk about it very fairly. If you follow the comics community on Twitter, everyone wants to act like it's a big happy family, that we all love each other, that everything is based entirely on merit and ability, that there is no real favoritism, while in the same breath constantly talking about how you really need to be a nice person. If you're not a nice person, it'll catch up with you. So, I do think it is important to be aware of and acknowledge these things. And sometimes, often, when you feel like you're on all the time, be it for YouTube or for cons, where you're constantly having to present this very guarded, very neutrally pleasant personality that has no strong opinions, no strong desires, no strong complaints, you know, it's exhausting. It wears you out. It makes you sick if you're not naturally that kind of a person. And I know you guys know me pretty well by now. You watch this channel, you know I'm very passionate, very opinionated. I do try to back up my opinions with research and examples, but I try not to judge people too quickly. I try not to talk ill of people, but I do have strong opinions, and I do not believe that brands deserve to be treated like people. And that's something that disturbs me about our culture in the US, is that we brands are actually considered individuals by our government, and I think that is 10 kinds of effed up, because we don't even treat people like people sometimes. Maybe that's going to make it harder for me to find advertising. People who are interested in advertising on this channel saying that I don't think brands are people. I think brands hire people. I think small companies hire people and can represent people. But I'm not going to give a brand my loyalty. And that's one of the things I have like a very, very strong opinion about. And that I'll pop off on rants sometimes. And I've been warned by other comic people, you know, you're going to scare away employers. You're going to scare away your audience. But the point of this channel is to help you guys and to help educate you guys. And I feel like lying about my experiences isn't going to help anybody. It's not going to help companies who are interested in improving their products, because, you know, if everybody's only saying positive things about their stuff, but then they don't buy it, that doesn't help them. That's just confusing for them. So all I ever really want is to see improvement. I want improvement for myself. I want improvement for others. And sometimes the best way I know to go about doing that is by being passionate and opinionated. But, you know, on the flip side, I'm aware that that could be killing my chances at having a career. It is a sad thing to have to consider changing your personality for a potential job. Not even a job. Not even like an actual concrete job. But just like the potential. And I think it's wrong to have to, you know, really change who you are on a whim like that. All right. So we've got everything inked. It's got kind of a single line weight. I wasn't really trying to push varied line weights at this point in time. The thing we need to do now is we need to allow this, let me pull out so you guys can see. We need to allow this to dry for at least 1 hour,
preferably 24 hours. That allows the ink to cure. It's going to prevent it from smearing. Then we're going to erase this. So hopefully I will see you guys tomorrow and we can continue working on this. Hey guys, good morning. So it's been about 12 hours since I inked this and I'm going to go ahead and begin erasing. All right, we're gonna brush this off. And if there are any pencil marks still on the page, we're gonna go back and erase those. And that meowing you hear is my cat trying to force his way onto my lap. And you might think, oh, that sounds so cozy, but not really. He doesn't know how to velvet his claws. Or maybe he knows and he just does not care. You don't care. No. Do what you want. He's going to make working on this very difficult, so I'm going to go ahead and take a break, prepare my workspace, and grab a cup of water to paint with. Alright guys, so we've got our Copic opaque white, we've got a synthetic brush, and we've got a little container of water, and I'll zoom out a bit so you guys can see what I'm doing. And this sort of paper is not designed to, oh shoot, look at that, can you see that? That's gross, isn't it? It like crystallized. Okay, that's fine. We can actually use white gouache. We just can't work with it directly from the container. So, note to self, even if your Copic opaque white container has been closed tightly for months, even just like 2 months, it will dry out and get ruined. And there's like cracks all within it. So I'm going to try reconstituting with water because I'm cheap and this is for science. But I'm also going to go grab some white gouache and a palette. And I'll be right back. And if you guys hear weird noises in the background, that's my printer. I am printing off stuff for Schwibby. All right, so I've got my white gouache, and it's actually in a lid of something, but you don't really need anything too fancy. And I'm actually using a synthetic brush. Those do tend to work a little bit better. And I'm going ahead and mixing up my gouache to a creamy consistency. We're actually using the Princeton synthetic that was sent to me in an art snacks a little while ago. And it's okay if you go over your line art. We can re-ink that area. And we may decide to go over some areas for coverage. And we want to keep our layers pretty light since this paper cannot really take a whole lot of water. This is not a mixed media paper. And we will get some warping and some buckling due to the water that we've added to our gouache. And I'm probably going to have to go over the skirt again after it dries. Sort of try to smooth it out right now. Definitely going to have to re-ink part of this to clean it up. And that's okay. All
All right, I'm going to let that dry. All right, guys, with that first layer dry, we're gonna go ahead and add a second layer selectively, mostly in these larger areas that could really benefit from more opacity. And because that layer is thicker, it will take longer to dry. So if you want to put it somewhere that has good ventilation, like under a vent, that might be a good idea, especially if you're working in a hurry. All right, guys. So that first layer has pretty much dried, or rather those two layers have pretty much dried. We're going to move on now to our water-based gold ink. You want to make sure you shake this stuff really, really, really well because it does settle. And sometimes it's pretty hard to get that cap off too. Man, gonna have to go use that rubber band trick. All right, for those of you who don't have a lot of wrist strength like myself, sometimes wrapping a rubber band around the top can give you enough friction to get the cap off. Of course, I did that off camera because I wasn't thinking. Actually, I thought it was on camera. New setup kind of forces me to constantly check. This is a water-based gold ink. Let me zoom in for you guys. It's much more impressive in real life than it is on camera, unfortunately. And for this illustration, I'm starting in with the berries. And I'm not really concerned if I go out of the lines because I'm going to tighten up my line art later on anyway. Unfortunately, this little synthetic red sable is pretty wrecked, so it's not going to give me very nice lines. And I don't really like using nice natural hair brushes with these sort of things because they tend to ruin them. So that's my own fault. Anyway, I'm going to let that first layer dry because it's clear. We're going to have to go over that again. All right, guys, so that first layer dried, and I'm switching over to a different synthetic. Hopefully we'll have fewer issues. This is a Dura handle synthetic brush. I think I got it from Jury's a while back. First thing I want to do is I want to fix these lines. These lines are looking pretty sad. So we're going to go ahead and do a second layer over them very carefully because we don't really want to reactivate that white gouache we put down. And that looks like it might work. Might even need a third though. Stuff does dry pretty thin. And you don't have to use this if you have a gold marker you prefer. You can use that instead. I probably should have grabbed that, in fact. I also have a gold acrylic that works a lot better than this. It's just not as nice a color. Something about my book wants to just stick to the surface of my craft mat, and it makes it very hard to rotate. All right. So I know that's looking pretty rough right now. Just gonna have to let it dry and deal with it later. All right, let's continue our fight with this gold ink a little longer. As you can see, there are a lot of patchy areas where it just doesn't cover very well. And I'm not sure if that's because the gouache is providing a resist. This is not an acrylic gouache, it's a water-based WInsor and Newton gouache. So I'm not entirely sure why that would happen. And of course, as is always the case, no one talks to me until I hit record and then people want my attention. I apologize for that. So I notice that I'm getting kind of frustrated with this. I'm really kind of getting annoyed with fighting with the gold ink. And if you're doing art for relaxation, this is a good time to walk away from it because you're just going to undo all of the good that you're trying to do for yourself. You're just going to make yourself angry and frustrated. And you'll end up doing a worse job than if you stepped away from it for a few minutes. And of course, you guys can see that this particular gold is actually pretty translucent, and that is definitely part of the problem with the dress down there. Oh shoot, there is an eraser shaving in there. Awesome. Now I would switch over to a different gold, but they do sometimes have different colors to them, different hues, and that might look kind of weird or like poorly planned. So I guess I'm going to continue to struggle with this gold. And then I'm going to work from top to bottom, and I'm already noticing that my gold ink is starting to settle out. So I should probably recap it and shake it soon. All right, now to let that layer dry before I can go a little heavier. Alright guys, that gold ink has finally dried, so now we can go ahead and add another layer to it. Do you guys find painting or drawing or markering around spiral binding maybe as annoying as I do? I know I could rip the page out, but honestly, me with loose pages in this studio, that's bad news. Stuff is always getting lost, so it's better if I just grumble a little bit and work around it. Of course, by now we've kind of figured out that in order to get an opaque gold coverage, we need about 3 layers or so of gold. So this is actually gonna take a while. And I'm even sort of taking advantage of the fact that most of the gold particles have fallen to the bottom by sort of dredging the bottom to scoop up those particles. Trying to get a more even, opaque coverage. But as you guys know, we do need to allow it to dry before we can do another layer on top of it. And by now we have mostly opaque coverage. There are a couple of spots that I'm gonna go back into. Oh, wow. I got like all of the gold for a second there. All of it came up in one pigmented lump. I'll just go ahead and touch up those sections. I don't want to over apply, mostly because this area has already received several layers of gouache. Well, 2, and then many layers of this stuff. that we've got that done, I'm actually going to pull out a gold pen, but I want to test it first to see if it's the right color. So I'm going to go ahead and do that over here. Unfortunately, my luck with these sort of pump action shaky pins is terrible. It's putting out liquid, but it's not putting out metallic, and I guess you guys can't see that at all. All right, there we go. Kind of dark, but that's all right. It's got a nice color to it. So we will use this in a minute, and I'll grab a white Signo. All right, let's go ahead and pull our black ink out. It's time to do some fills. We're not doing any corrections just yet. I want to save that for the end. Zoom out some. And if you want to, you can use a liquid ink. I'm using a brush pen because it is handier. And it doesn't put quite as much water onto the page. And I've noticed we're having a little bit of trouble with that, so. When I was not too much younger than I am now, I thought everything had to be done in one go. So I didn't realize, and part of this was stupidity, but this was also kind of how it was presented to me. I thought, you know, I would have had to do all the spot blacks at one time, so I wouldn't have been able to go back and do them. You know, I thought that going back and doing corrections and adding additional black ink like I'm doing now, that all had to be done at one time. Everything had to be perfect on the first go round. And I just found that to be incredibly discouraging when I was younger. And now I know better, and I know that's not the case, that you can go back and you can fix things and you can add details. And I'm not really sure why that didn't click for me at the time, or why it took so long for me to understand that it's okay to do that. But it is okay to do that. You guys, you can go back, you can fix the things you need to fix. It's not cheating. You know, I hear so many screwy ideas from young artists about what is and what isn't cheating, and it's just like, dang, who lied to you? Who told you all those mean things? Working from reference, that's not cheating. That's, you're building up your accuracy, you're building up your visual vocabulary. That's perfectly all right. And how dare people say that's less creative? To me, that sounds like a bull excuse by people who are too lazy to do their own research. And they feel guilty because your pieces are looking better than theirs, so they're going to knock you down a peg. When I was in fifth grade, I was being tested. This was like the fourth time I tried out for talented art. And I'd gotten really, really good at sort of rendering illustrations in watercolor, but I had to work from reference. So I was good at illustration, maybe not necessarily geared towards fine art. And in the test, and this is way before smartphones, during the test, we were not provided any sort of reference. We weren't allowed to go to the library to seek reference. And I was just stumped because, you know, the sort of things that I'd gotten comfortable drawing were these, I was actually obsessed with poison dart tree frogs at that age. So I drew a lot of illustrations of frogs sitting on leaves, frogs on bark. And that's what I wanted to do. They were like, it was some open-ended prompt about drawing your favorite things, and I just wanted to draw a really cute frog, because I really liked frogs at the time, and I still do. But I wanted to do it from reference, and I wanted to do it realistically, and I'd drawn the frog so many times, and I was so obsessed with those frogs that I could do the frog very well from memory, but I remember really struggling with the tree bark. And for the first time ever, we had a time limit. I could see the time limit running out. And for the first time ever, I'd felt anxiety over drawing. And it wasn't like I'd been this, you know, protege, talented little artist. I really wasn't. I just always kind of kept my drawing on the down low, you know, something I did. And I did it in art class, but I didn't I wasn't trying to compete, and I didn't consider myself the best one in the class, and I didn't, you know, bring my drawings to school to brag about them to other kids. I just, that was like a thing I did to relax. And one of my teachers had happened to notice some of the drawings I'd done on my binder cover, and that's how the ball on that had gotten rolling. But that the time limit and the lack of reference and the expectation that I would come up with something in less than an hour, it just really made me anxious. And this is something that has followed me into adulthood. This is something that I've noticed occur in my life time and again, is if you put me on the spot and you demand that I draw something, I'm going to freeze up. I can write something. You know, it's writing has always been more natural for me than drawing. Drawing is something that I worked really hard to acquire, but it's not something I would consider myself naturally good at by any means. And I just, it really freaked me out a lot doing it. And, you know, I mean, part of the nature of classes is that, you know, you are expected to do those sort of things. And when I was at SCAD, they would frequently give us these little timed assignments with no reference, and we didn't have the option to go seek reference, since at that time cell phones weren't allowed in class. And I mean, I would get it done, but sometimes it was by the hardest, and it always looked terrible, and I always just felt so discouraged. And those of you who've met me at cons are probably wondering, well, you know, commissions aren't very different from that. And the thing is with me in commissions, while I can do it if somebody is there, I kind of would prefer not to. I'm very easily distracted. And it makes what I need to do harder. So I would really prefer not to, you know, sit around and chat while I'm working on your personal commission. It is a little frustrating having people hover over and watch. Now, if you ask me ahead of time if you can watch, I'll say yes, because that is something we've agreed upon. It's not something that's just forced onto me. And I'm sharing this with you guys because, like I said, so many young artists have these strange notions about what is and what is not acceptable, what is and what is not allowed. And I feel like we just sort of perpetuate these myths and stereotypes that just make it harder for people to do what they need to do. We are making things unnecessarily hard for others with our own biases. So I try to talk to you guys about my experiences because I'm a little older than a lot of you. And I've certainly done many, many, many things. More so than most people, most comic artists my age have done, in, you know, just trying to make a sustainable life for myself. So I have a lot of experiences that I can share, and if my negative experiences can be used to help other people, you know, that those experiences had some value, and it's okay if I suffered because someone else was able to maybe skip some of the suffering that I went through. I don't know. That's just how I feel about it. I actually want to do a little gold highlight in her hair, I think, and then go over it with black. So I'm not going to color all of her hair, just a highlight. Anyway, it isn't uncommon for artists to sort of clam up in those sort of pressured situations. And I know there are a lot of people who have the sort of get good or nut up or shut up mentality. And that's, you know, the thing is, it's great if you work under that kind of pressure. It's great if you don't need reference. It's great if you can fake it. But, you know, you're kind of in the minority, and there are a lot of artists who might not own that they frequently use reference, because of the misconceptions about the legitimacy of it. But there are a lot of artists, more artists than you would think, who do use reference in their drawings. And that just makes for stronger drawings. And all of the artists who I've truly, truly respected did use reference. So, you know, it kind of comes down to, well, whose opinion do you trust? Do you trust these people who are butting in and telling you what to do and are not your professors and are not your mentors, and they have no actual interest in you becoming better? Or are you better off patterning your artistic career off of another artist who's achieved the things that you want to achieve and has the artistic abilities that you would like to have? It's something to think about. But in the end, what I really want for you guys is I want you to enjoy drawing. Not everyone is meant to be a professional, and this goes for myself as well as anyone else. So, you know, if you're making yourself miserable in the pursuit, and at the end you end up not attaining what you went for, you know, it was all of the sacrifices that you made grudgingly because someone else told you to make them, was it worth it? And I love drawing. Like I said, it doesn't come naturally to me. It's something I've worked really, really hard to pursue. I've sacrificed a lot for it, but that was my choice. Those were things I chose to give up because I wanted it. And I feel like, and there are definitely some things I regret, but I feel like if I died tomorrow, I really gave it a fair shot, and I've really done the best that I could, and I still managed to find enjoyment in what I do. So, you know, the reason I give you guys these pep talks sometimes is I want you to still love it. There's so many people I know, so many people I went to school with or are professional peers who have started hating art. They hate what they do. They hate themselves. They hate the things they produce. And I've felt that way too. You know, I've beaten myself up over all sorts of failures and all sorts of shortcomings. And it doesn't actually solve those problems, and it doesn't actually didn't make me a stronger artist. So I decided I was going to stop being abusive to myself, and I was going to start being encouraging and see if that, you know, didn't go further. I mean, when you're dealing with like a small child or animal or anything you're trying to train, encouragement works so much more, positive reinforcement works so much more than punishment. So I decided to stop treating myself worse than I treat my cat. I do love my cat, but I should love myself more, right? And I decided to stop mentally abusing myself for things that were out of my control. And I just want to also encourage you guys to not do that and to try and provide a positive example as much as I can. To like, maybe we can sort of rewire the way artists talk to themselves and the way we think about ourselves. Maybe we can exist in a healthier, more supportive community instead of a toxic community where we all quietly hate ourselves. I thought I had a white Signo gel pen handy, and it looks like I'm gonna have to go hunting, so I'll be right back. There we go. My pencil case was like literally right under my feet. And we're gonna use, hopefully this will work. If not, I gotta switch over back to the gouache, and it looks like it doesn't want to. Alright, fine. Switch back over to the gouache. It's gonna add some tiny white details using the Signo, but it did not want to draw over what I had down. But where I was originally going with this is, what I didn't know was you could go over things several times, refine your shapes, add details. I didn't know that was allowed until way later. I guess getting really into watercolor sort of taught me that, you know, sometimes the best way is not to give up when something doesn't come out perfect the first time, but to keep trying to find what you're looking for. And I'm using right now a pilot gold marker. And one of the artists I follow on Instagram showed one in a post. And I forgot what she did, and I forgot who exactly showed it. But she'd done this like halo around her character. It was like a mandala style halo, so it was all filled in, and it looked really cool. And I'm always kind of on the hunt for good silver and gold pins because I have terrible luck with them. So I thought I'd give it a try. And those of you who have used Derwent Graphic paint liners, it is a paint pen like that, like a fine point paint pen like that. I'm sorry, my cat is downstairs demanding, even though he was fed this morning, demanding that he be fed again. And the vet put the word on me a while back about him getting fat, and you know, because he's a Russian blue, he needs exercise and all that, so I have to ignore his cries. And the fact that I work kind of slow and gave the paper time to dry, there is a little bit of cockling, but not nearly as much as I thought I was going to get. I mean, I thought this was going to be like a hot train wreck, all cockled up, all buckled up, but no. Some gold freckles, because why not? And I need to allow all of this to dry before I can go back in and tighten up the line art. But I am pretty pleased with how this is turning out. I know it's hard to see due to the angle of my camera. So I'll see you guys in a few minutes. All right, guys, so everything has dried. Now we can work on tightening things up. I have here a Derwent Color Soft color pencil, and I'm just going to add some soft white highlights here and there if I can. Before I go ahead and tighten the rest of the illustration up. Not too much, because I don't want to detract away from like the sort of stark white of her outfit. And I'm not really trying to introduce an element of shading either. I'm going to take that white Signal pen and widen the ties on her shoes. Of course, if you go over Signo too shortly after you put it down, it'll sort of drag into it, leaving harsh lines. So you do want to be careful about that and let it dry before you try to widen the line too much. So, of course, I will check in with you guys once that's dried. All right, guys. So, hopefully that gold shadow is dried. And while I was watching it dry, I decided I'm just going to go ahead and use this white color pencil to add a bit of a white halo all the way around instead of just selectively. And I also decided I'm going to do a mask, and I'll show you that in a minute using some tracing paper, and we're going to do a splatter technique. You guys have seen me use splatter techniques in the past. If you're following along at home, a good way to do an easy splatter technique is using a synthetic watercolor brush. It can be cheap, and we'll take it from there. I thought I had a, I do have a flat. There, that'll work. So I'm going to finish the halo first, and then we're going to go ahead and do the splatter technique. And I've talked about this in a blog post about a year ago, but if you're looking for, something new to try, if you're feeling a little run down on inspiration, tone tan paper or tone gray paper, or really any tone paper, can add just like a new dimension to your work. It gives, your work will look different on this sort of paper, as you guys see here. I mean, we're really working with three colors plus the tone of the paper, and the gold looks so nice on this sort of neutral paper. It can be a really fun thing to play around with. So if you're feeling uninspired, it might be worth your while to go pick up a tone tan or a tone gray sketchbook, or even draw on some paper bags. There are plenty of artists who do that and who enjoy it. Cheaper way to play around with similar techniques. Now, you are going to get a different texture with the craft paper that paper bags are made out of, but you might enjoy it because it has a bit more of a texture than this. So it would bite the color pencil. You would get a better effect with your color pencil than I'm getting here, but you wouldn't be able to ink as neatly. So that might be a good time to pull out your Pintel pocket brush, especially if you're playing along doing the Inktober collection from Art Snacks. That would be a fun way to use your Pintel pocket brush. And that still counts for Inktober. I've even seen people expand Inktober to include marker work, since technically that is an ink-based product. So really, it's about finding the things you enjoy and inspire you, and challenging yourself to push your boundaries. All right. Go ahead and do that mask. You're going to need a sheet of tracing paper, and you might want to go ahead and tape down the edges, and I recommend you use something with a low tack, like a washi tape, and I always keep some by my desk. And you just want to tape it down so it doesn't shift while you're tracing your image. And those of you who've watched me do masking for alcohol markers are probably familiar with this. Nothing new here. And I recommend you don't use a pen, but we're going to just grab a color pencil since it's handy. And we're going to trace over where we did that outline. Not because I want to preserve that outline, but because it's easy. And since we're mostly just playing around with techniques today, easy can be good. See, my paper shifted even though I taped it down. Let me tape it. And this doesn't need to be neat or pretty. It's just a mask. Make a mistake and go over it. No big deal. All right, and then you just want to use scissors or an X-Acto knife, but in this case I'm going to use scissors because it's going to be easier to go ahead and cut your mask out. So I will check in with you guys after I have cut out my mask.
All right, so I've got my mask cut out. And remember how we talked about that low-tack tape? We're going to use this low-tack tape folded over in a few strategic spots just to hold this down. I kind of want to avoid putting it anywhere I put the gouache since I applied that kind of thickly, and I am a little afraid that that's going to just flake off on me. But honestly, you don't really need a whole lot. All right. First, we've got our gold paint. Rather, our gold ink. And my large flat brush is a little too big to stick in there. So we're going to go ahead and use a small one. That gives us smaller splatters, which do tend to go everywhere. So this is a messy technique. You want synthetic because the hairs are going to be springier. Let's see if we can't get some larger droplets with a larger synthetic. And next, I reactivated some of the white gouache in that cap. And we're using a cheap, wide brush. Get the gold off my fingers. And we're just flicking it tall way. Oh, got a big drop there. And I am making a huge mess on my desk. So you guys want to work in a large, well-covered area. Do not be a fool like me. Don't try to do this in a cramped, confined space because you will get it everywhere. All right. Of course, it is also messy. So this might not be the best technique if you're doing it at a con table. So we need to let this dry and then I'll check in with you guys. All right, guys, so our splatter has dried. It's time to go ahead and carefully remove that mask. And it's okay if the mask tears, as it just did right there. And now, finally, we're at the point that I keep promising that we're at, or that we're not actually at, but now we are. Now we're there. We're at the point where we can start tightening up some of those details. Let's go ahead and zoom in. Thank you. right, guys. Thank you guys so much for hanging out with me today. I'm really glad we did. I'm really glad we pushed through this, even though there were times where I didn't really feel that I wasn't really sure of the direction it was going. I wasn't satisfied with the direction it was going. I think it actually turned out really cute, and I'm glad you guys were there with me. I'm glad we got to experience it together, because it's always cool to be able to make something that is better than expectations on camera, and that way maybe you can show you guys when to push forward with something. That's the hope, and I hope I was able to encourage or inspire you guys today. I hope you enjoy hanging out with me as much as I enjoy hanging out with you guys. So, hopefully this will get you guys pumped for Inktober, and I have lots of other Inktober videos coming up shortly. So I hope you guys will continue to watch this channel. Keep an eye out for updates. If you haven't subscribed yet, please go ahead and do so, especially if you enjoy this sort of content. If you are a subscriber and you'd like to help me out, please take a moment to share this video to your social network, share it with your friends, introduce other artists, other people who might be interested in this sort of thing to my work. You're doing me a huge favor when you do that, because it allows me to grow my audience in a way that I can't do. So I would greatly appreciate that sort of support. If you are looking for more tutorials or maybe even Brushpen reviews, why don't you head over to the blog, natasoup.blogspot.com. I have loads and loads of reviews and tutorials over there. Hopefully it'll help you pick out a pen that works well for what you're looking for. Hopefully it'll inspire you. Finally, if you want to help fund future projects like this, or you want advanced sneak peeks and other goodies, head on over to the Patreon at patreon.com/natasoup for information on how to join my community of art nerds. So I'm Becca Hilburn. Thank you guys so much for coming and hanging in my studio today. It's always great to have you here. It's always awesome to catch up and talk. I hope you guys have a great rest of the day, and I hope to see you really soon. Bye!